To your name be the glory. sun fall before your throne. The only place for those who know it's not for us, it's all for you. Set your holy fire on this offering. Let the worship burn for the world to see. It's not for us, it's all for you.
Sing it out, not to us.
Not to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us, but to your name.
We are here to give him glory this morning, and we are blessed to be in this place, to be in his presence. I hope you are too. Lift this up to him. This is one of our new songs. It's an older song, but we want to sing it to him this morning. Blessed are those who dwell in your house, straight from Scripture. Sing this out to him this morning.
Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on our God. Go from strength to strength.
This morning, as we gather in this place, as we sing out praises to Him, Lord, hear our praises. We lift those up to You and ask that You would heal our land. Well, you may be seated, and Summer, why don't you come on up and do a little connecting.
Good morning. We've come to the part of our service where we like to connect and make you as our body and our visitors aware of what's going on. But as always, we want you to know here at FBA, we're not a perfect church, but we serve a perfect Savior. And we're all about lifting Jesus up, and He will draw you to Himself. And if you're a visitor, we have a little portion in our bulletin that tears out. It's this part. If you will write your name and your contact information and stick that in the offering plate during our time of collection, we will deliver you a gift. As our visitor, we want you to know that we love you because Jesus loves you. Well, they've asked me to do Connect because tonight I'm going to present on my trip to Israel. And I will just give you a little snippet of what I want to present and why I want to present. I'll tell you, this was my bucket list item. The one thing in life that I wanted to do was to go to Israel. And thanks to my husband being very supportive in my seminary and a great professor that I have, and the Lord, I was able to go to Israel for 14 days last March. And the entire time I was there, I just kept thinking, I'm a little bit country. I kept thinking, Lord, why have I been so blessed to get to experience this in my lifetime? Why have I had the privilege? Please, Lord, help me to take all of these experiences and to use them to glorify you. Please give me opportunities to share with others just what I'm experiencing in this land of Israel. And so that's what I'm going to do tonight. Also, one more thing I want to draw your attention to. If you look on the back of the bulletin, it says Fall Family Fellowship, Monday, October 19th at Maple Lane Farms. We want to make everyone aware that this includes our entire church body. So all ages, doesn't matter what group you're in, community group, Sunday school, Sunday night, everybody is invited. Our church has rented the entire place out, and there's hamburgers, hot dogs provided, and we're just asking that you bring a side. But we hope that this will be a great opportunity for our church body to fellowship together. All right. Time to greet each other, right? Okay. If you will get up and meet a few people you don't know and hug some necks of those you do know.
died, he sacrificed, and came near. Sing it.
Because you came near from the everlasting to the world we live. The Father's only Son.
Sing that to him.
Because you came near from the everlasting to the world.
Thankful for that. Give him glory and honor and praise this morning. And he's our true friend, as this song cries out today. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. I know you know this one. Lift this up to him as your praise this morning. Lifting him up this morning. What a friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. Sing it to him. we can truly sing that this morning. Amen. Thank you for singing. That was awesome singing this morning. Awesome worship. I want to welcome you once again this morning. We have a special guest with us this morning, Jim Snyder, our Director of Missions from the Chilhowee Baptist Association. He's going to be sharing the word with us this morning, so y'all pray for him. Would you welcome him this morning? Praise the Lord for him and his work at the Chilhowee Mission. Thank him for being here this morning and filling in for Freeman. As we prepare our hearts for our offertory, let's bow in prayer. Lord God, we just come before you today, and Lord, we proclaim that you are our friend. Lord, sometimes we cannot feel you. Sometimes we cannot sense you. Lord, but you are always, always, always there. And that's why we're praising you this morning, Lord. Because you loved us when we were still unlovable. You came when you didn't have to. You sacrificed your life, Lord, your son's life, and we thank you for that. Thank you for loving us so much that we can call you friend now. Because of your sacrifice, because of your blood, because of your love and your grace and your mercy. Lord, we can never repay that. Lord, we can never thank you enough. But Lord, take these praises that we give you this morning. Be magnified, be edified by them. Lord, be glorified by our tithes and our offerings and everything that we give you. Lord, through these songs, through these praises, and through these prayers, through these preaching and teaching, Lord, just be glorified. Glorified in our lives, Lord. Thank you so much. And in Jesus' name we pray this. Amen.
See? Well, good morning. It is a privilege to be here with you this morning, and I would bring you greetings from your sister churches that make up the Chihuahua Baptist Association. And we also have some guests with us today, travel from Australia just to hear me. Just kidding. They're here for the convention up in Pigeon Forge. I understand we got some Oklahoma people here, they won last weekend, decided they're going to make permanent residence here, but welcome the people from Oklahoma as well. And thank you for coming this morning as we worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and that we would bring Him glory, and that we would be His witnesses wherever we're at and whatever we're doing. I want to thank you on behalf of the association for your support, your prayers, and not only your people support, but also your financial support for the work that we do through the Chihuahua Baptist Association. God has blessed us, and we continue and seek ways in which we can partner together for ministry and missions in our local neighborhoods and literally throughout the world. I'd invite you to come this October the 15th, our annual meeting at Central Baptist Church, Central Point Baptist Church in Rockford, just off Millertown Pike, and be a part of that. Not Millertown, but Martin Mill Pike. I get those two interchanged sometimes, to come and be a part of that. We have our missionary from Mali, West Africa. We've been partnering for about 6 years now with the Maninka people in West Africa. And Daryl Cox will be with us and sharing with us a little bit about what God is doing there, and the work that will continue on in the days to come. We had a team from Beech Grove go out in May, and we had a breakthrough in one of our villages. We had 20 young men come to make professions of faith in Jesus Christ, and we're in that process of trying to disciple those young men in that village. And you pray with us as we seek to send out teams as many times in the next couple of years to begin that discipleship process. I was reading an article, and a young man, Scott Bradford, was sharing a story. He said he had been to a wedding reception some distance out into the country, and he was about ready to prepare to leave, and one of his friends comes up to him and says, well, Scott, just remember, for every mile that you travel, there's 2 miles of ditches. He said that until I got into my car and began to drive back, that it really didn't strike me. But he said, but you know, as we're traveling through life, for every mile that we travel, there's 2 miles of danger. Sometimes we approach life as we're going through life, and we think things are going smoothly, and then danger suddenly creeps up on us. And life is like that. We don't intend to go off into the ditch. Sometimes it's just a matter of us just kind of wandering and drifting to one side or the other, and then all of a sudden the wheel drops off into the ditch and pulls us into that ditch. Sometimes we're distracted and we look off and we see something that grasps our attention just for a brief moment, and before you know it, we're off into a ditch. Well, in the book of 1 John, the Apostle John does a wonderful job of, one, highlighting to us some dangers that we face in our Christian journey. But more importantly, he gives us some thoughts and some principles, some reminders, so to speak, of things that we can do in our Christian walk, in our Christian journey, that will help us to keep on the path that God has set before us in our Christian walk, in our Christian journey. So if you want to turn with me to 1 John chapter 2, we will spend some time 1 John chapter 2 through 1 John chapter 4 and looking at some of these truths in here. The first thing we see is that John reminds us of some of the ditches that are so often pulling us and trying to distract us to get us off our journey with the Lord. The first thing that John reminds us of is worldliness. If you look when 1 John chapter 2, verse number 15, it says, "Do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of this world. So he begins right here and reminds us of three of the major areas of sin. And really, if you look at all of our sins, they could fall into one of the three categories. The lust of the flesh, which is simply that self-gratification of wanting to satisfy our own physical needs and the things that we have. So that self-gratification, permeates our society today. Whatever makes you feel good is the things that our world says that we ought to pursue. Then we have the lust of the eyes, and simply that's our selfish desires, and that's where envy creeps in, and we begin to desire and want things that others have, and we think we need to have those all for ourselves. And then he mentions the pride of life, and that's that basically self-centeredness. We become self-focused, self-absorbed, and really the most important person in the world is me. We began to have that attitude, and we know that those types of attitudes, those things pull us away from God, are the things that the world tries to push, and the world tries to say that that's what's most important, and they're contrary to God's will and God's desire for us. So John reminds us that worldliness sometimes creeps into our lives and pulls us off the journey, the path that God has set for Christians. The second area that John reminds us of is that of false teaching. If you look at the beginning of verse 18, it says, "Little children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For had they been of us, they would have continued with us, but they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us." I think as a Christian body and Christian believers and followers of Jesus Christ, one of the most significant dangers we have today is that of the false teachings that so permeate, particularly our Western culture. We see different preachers and so forth on TV and on the radio, and then we hear people in different pulpits that are continually speaking part of the truth but not the whole truth on there. We know that popular today in our society, and it's even spreading to other parts of the world. I know that it's present in West Africa, as we've experienced that, is that's the prosperity gospel. That if you just name it, claim it, God wants to bless you, and if you if you're giving to Him and serving Him, that He's going to bless you. And if He's not blessing you, there's something wrong with your lifestyle with Him. Well, we know that's contrary to what Scripture teaches us. The Bible says that if we live for God and live for Christ, that there are going to be struggles that we face because we're going to be at enemy with the world. Now, God certainly wants to bless us, and He does bless us, and He gives us joy and peace in our journey. But we need to be careful about that prosperity gospel of just saying that if we do certain things, somehow God's going to be pleased with us, and He's going to lavish all of these monetary rewards to us and somehow bless us financially. He may choose to do so, but that's not as a whole. He does not always do that. The other thing that we face in today's society is the whole evolutionary thought concept of somehow that all that we are and all that we see around us somehow just happened. And it was just a matter of all sorts of different events through the millions and millions of years. And fortunately, we've got more and more scientists. Some are Christian, some are not, that are coming to the realization that the world that we live in, the body that we have, is tremendously sophisticated, and there everything seems to have an order to it, and somehow there seems to be a plan, and they come to realize quickly that life doesn't come except from other life. So we fortunately, we're seeing some of that trend reverse. But it is still there, and it drives us away from the fact that there is a God, there is a Creator God, and that we as people, as God's creation, should seek after Him and seek to worship Him and give Him the place and the position in our lives that He deserves. And then we have the false area around us, and the false teaching is that all of us are seeking the same God. We're just going after it in different means. I know you've probably seen the bumper sticker with all the different religious symbols on it, and it says coexist. And that sounds good, and it's something we ought to strive for. As Christians, the Bible teaches us for as much as possible within us, we're to live at peace with others, and we're to be the peacemakers, and we're to live in harmony. The Bible is very clear also that we are to live according to God's word, and we are to put Christ first in all things. And there are no compromises. Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. You see, Christ is exclusive. There are no other ways in which people can be brought back to the holy God, the Creator God, except through Christ and the sacrifice that He paid on our behalf for each and every one of us. So we see some of these dangers that are there. The last one I want to mention to you, the danger that we see sometimes that we don't realize is a danger, but it's that rest area as we're going along the road and we see that rest stop and we think, oh, let's take a break for a moment. In verse number 28, he says this. It says, now, little children, abide in him, and when he appears, we may have confidence and not be shamed of him. But at his coming, we also see over in Luke chapter 12, as far as trying to always be ready for the Lord. So many times I hear this. I grew up in my Christian walk and serving the Lord. I began as a youth pastor and a youth in education. In many years, this time of year was the nominating committee time of the year. And I'd be meeting with a nominating committee, and we'd be going out and asking various people if they would serve or continue to serve and so forth. And so many times I would hear this comment, well, I've served a long time, and I need to take a break for a little while. Or, you know, I'm getting older, and I just need to give that over to someone else, as if their ministry was finished. God never said we are to retire. Now, we may transition to something else, but God has something for every Christian. Whether you're young or whether you're old, God has a purpose and a plan for each of you. Sometimes those rest areas, they sound good. It says, well, I need a time of refreshing. And that's true. Sometimes you need to take a little break and so forth. But rest areas can distract us and get us off target, thinking that we need somehow to take a time off from what God has called us to do. Luke chapter 12, verse number 35 says this, let your waist be girded and your lamps burning, and yourselves be like men who wait for their master when he returns from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, the door may be opened to him immediately. You see, we always need to be ready for when God returns. We don't know when that hour will be, but we know that one day Jesus is going to return and he's going to take his bride, the church, home with him. And we don't want to be found wanting at the time and scrambling around, because we want to be prepared. So we should always be looking toward that day of his return and be prepared for that day. So we see that John has given us several reminders. There's other things and dangers that we do need to be mindful of, that as we read through the book of 1 John, 2 John, he does a great job of reminding the Christian of staying on target. But I want to share with you basically five reminders from John that will help us to stay on God's path, to stay on his journey, so that we don't fall into a ditch or get distracted and we end up in that danger area within our lives, within our heart. The first reminder that John gives us in John chapter 2, verse number 24. Now, if you want to turn back to John and take a look at that, verse number 24 says, therefore let abide in you that which you have heard from the beginning. Faith is our beginning point in our journey. The moment that we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we found that forgiveness of sin through His shed blood, and we've accepted that payment that penalty for our sin that he took upon himself on the cross. We accept that in faith. That is the beginning of our journey. And it's an amazing journey that God has for us. And we need to remember that that was a great price in order for us to even get on the road that leads us to God and will help us to complete the Christian journey that God has before us. Faith was and is our beginning point. We abide in him and we remain in him. If you look at the very beginning of 1 John, John does a good job of a testimonial, so to speak. He says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, and we have looked upon with our hands and have handled concerning the word of life. That life was manifested, and we have seen, bear witness, and could declare unto you the eternal life which the Father has manifested to us. You see, he's given that personal account. He said, this faith, this Jesus, this salvation that we offer to you, we've seen it, we've handled it, we know that the word is true, and we're bearing witness of that. We need to abide in that faith and go back to that time in which we surrendered our hearts and our lives to Christ and remember that we can go back to that point at our beginning point and that God has set us on this path to this journey in which he wants us to complete for his glory and for his honor. The second aspect that John reminds us of is the mode of our journey, and that is in love. Chapter 3, verse 1 says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called children of God. God has initiated his love in our hearts and our lives. And the only way we're going to be able to stay on target and to stay on God's path is we need to have that mode of love in everything we do. It ought to permeate the very essence of our being. We should have the mind of Christ in everything we do. If there's one thing that we lack, it's that constant attitude of love for one another. More so within the church, we certainly need to love and support and to take care of the needs of those around us. But the Bible says we are to love those outside the church as well so that we can point them to Christ and point them to a God that loves them and shares with them. Love is to be expressed through every aspect of our life and the aspects of believers. In John chapter 4, beginning in verse number 7, it says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifest toward us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Then down in verse 11, beloved, if God so loves us, we ought to love one another. The other thing that the scriptures remind us of, and I believe it is listed there in verse 3:19, but as we love and we demonstrate our love to others around us, it should reassure us that we are on the right path, that we're on God's team, and that we have a relationship with him. If you find yourself, if you discover that you're having a hard time loving others around you or having a heart of compassion, even for those that disagree with you or think differently than you, then you might want to question, where's my relationship with the Lord at? Because the more we fall in love with Jesus, the more we're going to have a passion and a heart and a concern for those around us. And the more we'll want to sacrificially put our lives intersecting with their lives so that we can build a relationship with them. Aaron Cole, who is one of the vice presidents for the North American Mission Board, in one of his books, he had written out basically just a simple outline talking about how we are to love those around us and be on God's mission for him. And he tells us several things. One is we need to identify lost people around us. And that's really not hard to do. On any one given Sunday, less than 30% of our population is in church. That means 70% of our neighbors, friends, co-workers, those that we do business with, we travel alongside, we're at the ball field with, they're not actively involved in any church. And now that 70%, probably 50% of those have no church affiliation and no desire to be affiliated with any church. So what about the 70% in Blount County? We just forget about them? No, we need to identify who those are. It could be a coworker, it could be an acquaintance, it could be someone on the ball team, one of the families that you've met, it could be one of the people at the school, one of the other parents that you work alongside in the PTO. You need to find out who those people are. We need to identify the lostness around us. Make a little list, a mental list or a written list, and begin to pray for those. That's the second thing he says, is not only we're to identify them, but we're to invest in them. In other words, we're going to have to take time to get to know them, to fellowship with them, to build a relationship with them, to find out what some of their needs are, what some of their desires are, what some of their troubles or issues are. I like what Paul says over in 1 Thessalonians when he was commending the Thessalonians for their faith. He said, "But remember when I came to you," he said, "not only did we present the gospel to you, but we presented our very lives to you as well." As Christians, we need to have that same attitude. We've got to be willing not only present the gospel to people, because a lot of people think, well, you know, if they don't care for me and they're just trying to sell me something, they're not going to listen to you. But if you invest your life and you genuinely have a heart and concern for others around you, they're going to listen to you because they know that you care. They know that you have a love that they don't see in any other way. So we need to invest in people. The third aspect of that, he says, not only were you to identify and we are to invest in others, but we are also to invite them. Invite them to our church, but not only our church, because it's really not about our church. It's about inviting them to come into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if they become a part of our church and part of our fellowship, that's great. But that first step is we want to invite them into a relationship with Jesus Christ. That may be through inviting them to our church. It may be through inviting them to a time of Bible study at a coffee shop or a restaurant or someone's home. We just need to get into that purpose of inviting them into a relationship with Jesus Christ. And the last aspect of that is we are to increase. We are to increase our multitudes, increase that disciple making, where that we are encouraging others to take what they have heard and learned from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and take that to someone else. Just as John said there in chapter 1, he says, that's those things we've heard from the beginning, the word we know that is true, we're taking that and now we're sharing it with those around us. If you remember, John was the oldest living, or the longest living, of any of the apostles. And he continued in his faith and in his journey to the very end. So it's an inspiration to us when we hear and he tells us and reminds us that we're to abide in him and to go back and remember our faith and that beginning point that we have, but also the love that he shares with us. Well, you know, traveling, if you travel much, you know that traveling is really, it's a very tiring process. And particularly if we are investing in others and we're trying to build relationships with others, it can be very, very daunting and very challenging to us. And it can exhaust us not only physically, but emotionally and sometimes spiritually. So we need to be reminded of the fuel that we have in our journey. And that is found in the second chapter, beginning in verse number 27. It says, "But the anointing which you have received abides in you, and that you do not need anyone to teach you, but the same anointing teaches you concerning all things, and is true, and is not a lie, and just as it taught you, you will abide in him." Who is him? In Jesus Christ. We have the anointing of Jesus Christ that gives us the strength that we need to continue on. That's why I said it was so important to know that if you're having a hard time loving others and having a compassion to reach out to others in need, particularly those in spiritual darkness, then you got to say, well, what is my relationship with Christ like then? Because Christ came to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to love and express the love of the Father to all people, that through Him they can find forgiveness of sins if they were willing to repent and turn to Him and accept Him and the gift that God has given to us through His Son, Jesus. I like Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. We've got to be so in tune with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that He will supply all of our needs, that we'll be ready and equipped to invest in the lives and the others. So that is our fuel, that is our energy, and we've got to be dependent upon Him in all that we do. Well, John also tells us, the fourth thing that he tells us, he reminds us that we have a compass in which to help keep us on this journey so that we're not distracted and we don't make a wrong turn. We have that compass. Well, a compass, as you know, has two different things. One is a compass helps us identify what true north is. What is true north? True north is God's Word, unchanging Word, God's eternal Word that expresses to us God's plan for all mankind. I heard a preacher from England, David Tucker. He's been in our area several times. But someone asked him one time, said, well, David, can you give us an outline of the Bible, a brief outline of the Bible? He said, well, certainly. Genesis 1 and 2, God's creation. Genesis 3, the fall of man. Genesis 4 through Revelation, God's plan for redemption. Redeeming His creation, His special creation, you and I, back to Himself. So God's unchanging Word is our standard. That is due north. And as you know, sometimes you don't know where north is, and so what you do is you get a compass out, and that little needle points to north. So then you adjust your compass to north where the needle's pointing, and then you know what directions you are to head. So that's the Holy Spirit that is there present in our hearts and our lives that will continually guide us in that process. You can find that reference there in chapter 2, verse number 20, as the Holy Spirit bears witness of the truth to us and brings to our hearts and comforts us and points us in the right direction for our journey. Well, the fifth thing that that John gives us, and there's many others, but I'm just sharing with you five, and some of you are saying, thank the Lord, there's only five. Although a couple of my friends said, oh, we'll get out early today because Jim's preaching. It is good to come into God's house and to learn from Him. But the fifth thing he says here, John reminds us that every believer is to focus on the journey of our destination. It's not the journey itself, but our destination. If you look in chapter 2, verse number 25, it says this, and it says, and this is the promise that He has promised us, eternal life. Eternal life. Jesus, when He was standing before Pilate, and Pilate asked Him, are you a king? And Jesus says, my kingdom is not of this world. It's an amazing statement, but it's a very true statement. You see, Jesus' kingdom and our destination point is not this world. Our hope is not in this world. It's not in the governments of the world. It's not in the perceived solutions to the world. Our hope is in that final destination of eternal life with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. You see, the Bible teaches us that there will be a new creation, a new heaven, a new earth, a new Jerusalem, and there will be no need for the sun or the moon in that place because the glory of the Lord will illuminate that place. In the book of Revelation, it tells us that will be a place where there will be no more sorrow, there will be no more tears, and think about this, there will be no more temptation that we won't have to struggle with the flesh and the desires of the flesh and the lust of the heart and the pride of life, because we will be in perfect union with our Heavenly Father. We will have reached our destination point, and our hope is not in anything around us. Our hope is in that destination of eternal life with God forever and ever and ever. There's a couple of things about our hope in eternal life. One is, we know that eternal life involves two things. It involves a complete restoration, and it also involves that complete transformation. A good example of that complete restoration is in the prodigal son. You know, he goes away from his father, and he wastes all of his inheritance and so forth. And he comes to the realization that his father's servants are well taken care of, and they have food to eat, and they have a shelter. So he says, I'm going to go back to my father, and I'm going to confess that I have sinned against God, and I've sinned against him, and I'm going to ask him to take me back as a servant. You all know the story. He approaches the father, and the father sees him while he's still yet way off, leading us to know that the father was looking for him to return. And he comes and he confesses to his father, says, you know, I've sinned against heaven, I've sinned against you, take me as a servant. What does the father say? No. Bring the robe, put on my son, bring the ring and place upon his finger, and give him sandals to put on his feet, and let's have a party. For my son, he was dead, but now he is alive. He was lost, but now he is found. You see, the father completely restored him to be his son. He didn't make him a servant. He says, I completely restore you back into that relationship. That's what God wants to do for each and every one of us. When we confess him, when we acknowledge our sins before him, and we say, God, I'm committing my heart to you, my life to you. I'm one of your servants. He said, now come, I'm making you as one of my sons. The Bible says that we are going to be joint heirs with Jesus Christ. That means that all that God has given Jesus, which is everything, Jesus wants to share with us, because we're joint heirs with him. He wants to share that, his inheritance, with each and all of us for that. But also we have that complete transformation that takes place. And we see in chapter 3 of 1 John, chapter 3, verse number 2, and it says this, and the example of that complete transformation is, Beloved, now we are children of God. It has not yet been revealed to us what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, speaking of Jesus, we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And there's a beautiful passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that illustrates this as well. It says, for we know that our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed. We have a building from God, a house not made of hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with the inhabitation which is from above. Indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but be further clothed, immortality may be swallowed up by life. Now he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who also has given us his Spirit as a guarantee. God has in place for us that complete restoration of restoring us back into that perfect relationship with him for all time. We know that desire is the desire of God. You remember in the garden, man and woman, God's perfect creation, walk with him and fellowship with him. They were able to commune with him and talk with him at any time. But man broke the covenant with God, and sin entered the world. But Jesus wants to restore us to that. That's why he was able to say to the thief on the cross that had confessed him as Lord, he said, today you will be with me in paradise. The word paradise there was a Babylonian term that referred to the inner garden of the king. So Jesus was saying, today you will walk with me in my inner garden. You'll have that fellowship with me, and we'll be together for all eternity. That is our destination point. That's where we need to focus our lives and where we're heading. Because there are going to be struggles, there are going to be trials and temptations all around us. But if we keep our eyes focused upon the hope that is in the eternal, then the things of this world will grow strangely dim, because we know that our ultimate destination is with God. Psalm 16:11 kind of is a great summary verse for John's plea to us to stay on his journey. Psalm 16, verse 11 says this: you will show me the path of life. That's our beginning point. We know that we have a place of faith in Christ that we begin our journey on. He says, you will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. That process of going through the journey, God is going to walk with us. He said he's given us his Holy Spirit as a comforter, as a guide, as a witness, as a promise to remind us that we are one of his and that we're on this journey together. But he says, you will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Our destination. Pleasures forevermore. When there'll be no more sorrow, no more struggles, no more temptations there. We'll be in perfect unity with God in his garden, walking with him once again, just as he had planned for us in the beginning. So where are you at in your Christian journey? Have you been sidetracked and pulled off into a ditch because of selfish ambition or worldly pleasures? Maybe you've been distracted because you felt a little physically or spiritually tired, and you just kind of went into the rest stop, and you've never got back on the road, on the journey that God has for you. Those rest stops are okay, but they're not intended for you to stay very long. There's not a place to lodge at a rest stop. God wants you back on track, on his journey. God has something for every person that is a member of his body. He says something that he wants you to do, to work for him, to serve him, to glorify others, to lift them up, and to bring them into faith with Jesus Christ. He has a purpose, a plan for each one of you. So where are you at in your journey? Are you expressing God's love? Or do you realize that there's some love missing because you really don't have much compassion for others? If you have a lack of love, then you need to shore that up, your relationship with God, because he's going to give you that love. And if you're serving him and seeking him and honoring him and worshiping him on Sunday morning, but you leave out of here without love in your heart, you've not worshiped him. Your worship will show up in how you love and treat others throughout the week. Where are you at in your journey? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for John, that his life, his testimony bears witness to us even today, Lord, of things that we need to be reminded of. Father, I've examined my own heart, my own life, Lord. I know there's many times that I've drifted off and I've found myself being pulled into a ditch. But Father, you teach us that if we will repent and we will confess, you'll completely restore us and forgive us and to cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. Lord, thank you for that promise. And Father, I know that there's probably here some here today, Lord, that have gotten off track, have gotten distracted, Lord. That have been pulled into a ditch or into a rest stop, and they've just stayed there, Lord. But Father, you give them the opportunity to return to you. Father, we're thankful for that. Father, help us to be true to our faith. Father, help us to be filled with your love. Father, help us to be consistent in staying on target by staying in your word and being guided by your Holy Spirit. Father, we pray that as we give you this time of response today, Father, that you'll move in our hearts, and Father, that you'll let each one of us know what we need to do, whether it's to spend some time in prayer for you, Father, or maybe it's to respond and come to the response room, Lord. Father, we're just going to give you the time in our hearts and our lives that you deserve, and do the things that you're asking us to do. Father, we pray and ask and seek these things in Christ's name and for his glory and for his honor. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jim. Would you stand with us once again this morning? And we're going to sing a song of response to that, of what Jim said about presenting your lives back to the Lord, presenting yourself before him. You need to do that today. The altar is open. Jim will be down here in the front. Matt Dixon will be here as well. Denny, if you need prayer, come on down. These guys would love to pray with you. Lift this song up to him as we depart this morning.
I hear the Savior sing, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thy all in all. Jesus, pray it all, come to hear my love. Sin had left a crimson stain, he
this morning. Amen. Amen. Lift it up to him. That's all right. Thank you, Jim, for joining this morning. If you made a decision this morning, or if you just like to talk to someone, there is a hospitality room right around the corner here out in the hallway. Just head right out this way. There'll be some counselors there if you want to have prayer or anything with them as we depart this afternoon. Thank you all. Great worship this morning. God bless
Thanks
you.
Thanks for watching today. As we kind of wrap this service up, the most important thing is, what have you done with Jesus Christ? We believe that all of life's answers are found in Him. And we preach that Jesus Christ has been crucified, He has been buried, and He rose again on the third day. So if you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, would you do that today? Invite Him to come into your heart. He'll forgive you of all your sin. He'll give you a new start, and He'll give you something worth living for, and that's His life. If you could communicate that to us via email, we have a website you can go to and just shoot us an email. If we can help you with any questions, we'd be glad to. Also, if you'd like to call us, 865-982-2661. Thanks for watching. God bless.